very much. My name is Jeremiah Perry. And I'd like to say out front that I believe that we are morally and physically bankrupt in this province. And at the risk of being a pessimist, I don't see any turning back. But so I guess my point is a couple of things I just wanted to touch on was, what is your feeling on like the HST increase? Because there is a perception out there on open lines and not only economists, but certain people out there is saying it seems like a barrel of oil needs to get up to $100. Well, isn't that counterproductive though? We've been there and we know what that is all about. And the HST, which is a regressive tax in itself, but there's a lot of people saying, well, that's okay. I don't think it is. I think it's all counterproductive. Having said that, I think a bunch of grade fives could have went down there on the hill and put that budget there. It's disgraceful. It is despicable. The same reason it's despicable. There's always some room for efficiency, though. There is always room. And I'm just going to point out one thing now. If I got to take Jerry Burns' word for it now, he was just on the TV there. And the university, for example, is a $500 million entity. $500 million is a lot of money coming from the taxpayers. And they're saying, and if we believe them, we can't really believe them, but 3% is what they're lashing for. So if you look at the Hope on Signal Hill there, and you look at that hotel there that was bought there, that's a lot of money. And I think it was $11 million, and if you had the work done on it, that's a lot of money. So can you see efficiencies in the system? And one more little point, and I'll take your time. Stan Marshall. And Dwight Ball goes in the back room and he talks to Stan Marshall. With all due respect to Stan Marshall, he's probably a very intelligent man. But here's what he said when he hit the microphones. He said three things. He said, I don't need the work. I don't need the money. But he said, I got to do this job. Well, it was like, because we look at the talk skimming on, Nalcor, just look at Nalcor, the board of Nalcor there, and the big, huge sellers. I mean, it's been in the news all over. So, was there any, what's your take on that? I know it's an opinion, but why didn't Stan Marshall in our predicament right now, because that salary is between $650 and $850, if I'm not mistaken, according to the Sunshine List. So why is it that Stan Marshall didn't need the job, didn't need the money? Why couldn't he say, well, you know what? I'm going to do this, whatever salary. I know it's an opinion, but that's what the top is, and that is now for, and he's a multimillionaire. So I'm going to take a minute right now. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. There's a couple of points there. Number one, on the HST, one thing that we talked about during the election campaign, and I've got included in my remarks for wrapping up tonight as to what we do differently, is we really need a fair tax review in this province as to how we, what are our tax sources of revenue and are we doing it fairly relative to other provinces. We do need, the province does need to increase its revenue base. The loss of revenue as a result of the collapse of oil prices is serious, and if we're going to maintain public services, then they had to raise more revenue. I don't question that. I said that in the election campaign. I would love to have gotten up, trying to get elected, and said in the election we roll back that 2% on the HST just like that, the way that the Liberals said. But I knew that we either had to have that revenue or replace it with some other revenue if we're going to have we're going to provide the services that we need. So we did have, taxes, our hospitals, our highways, our libraries, our schools. That's what, taxes are, you need that for, but it has to be fair. And I think where this budget particularly got off the rails, I suppose in a number of ways, but in particular, that the tax burden that was applied was anything but fair. On your, I should have written them down. On the latter one about Mr. Marshall, he has decided that. If it's a salary for people, I suppose he can decide whether or not he takes it. But I think what we do need is a candid appraisal on Muskrat Falls. It was interesting that at the time of the budget, while we cut things like libraries, there wasn't a word of discussion or debate about doing anything other than saying, yes sir, no sir, three bags full, and turning over $1.3 billion without a word of, without a beat to Nalcor. There's one other point. The university. Well, there's a tangly issue. I think the idea of access to a post-secondary education without being burdened with debt is, you know, is certainly something that we need. When I was lucky enough to catch the very last year of free tuition when we had it, I got to tell you that I would have made it there anyway, some wouldn't. That was back some time ago, I might say. And there are issues with the physical facility there that sorely need attention. I'm not knowledgeable enough on the full details of the university, the budget, to say what the implications are of finding 3%. But I'm sure it would be a challenging one. Anyway, we can go to.
No, I'm not going to make a point about content because we want to hear from you. But one thing we didn't tell you, and which some of you are going to say you're telling us now, 3 minutes each. I'll tell you when 3 minutes are up, and I'll give you a bit of leeway. But we do want as many people as possible to speak because we want to hear what you have to say about the impact on you and impact on people that who are part of your life.
Hi, my name is Ed Sodden, and I'm a long-term advocate for pharmacare and mental health. And I'm appalled by the cutbacks to the Newfoundland and Labrador prescription drug program, as well as the provincial government scrapping the adult basic dental program. I think both of them are regressive moves. When most of the country is trying to move forward to a national pharmacare program and a dental care program, especially for the working poor or the most vulnerable people in our society, I find it very shocking. You know, if this is what they're going to do, cut 12 million or a large segment of the drug plan, and scrap the dental plan, what's next? Are they gonna privatize, or are they gonna, you know, if a person needs certain surgeries or medical treatment, they're gonna cut that? What's next? You know, you talk about the next budget coming in September, you know, everybody's worried about that as far as healthcare. The other thing is I don't hear it much about from the provincial government about the federal government. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, Mr. Trudeau, I nickname him St. Justin, but Mr. Trudeau Jr. continues with Stephen Harper's cutbacks in health transfers. And the other thing is, our Liberal MPs here in Newfoundland, Labrador, Nick Whalen and Seamus O'Regan, Yvonne Jones and the others, I don't hear them screaming at Justin and saying, hey, we need equalization. If we had equalization, perhaps, nobody's certain, but perhaps we wouldn't be seeing these cutbacks, especially healthcare. And we need a national health accord, and I don't see them saying anything in Ottawa. I like to see the federal government, especially the Liberal MPs in this province, stand up for our province for a change. I mean, a previous premier, even though I didn't vote for him, I voted for you, Lorraine, and Jack before that, and Earl. But Danny Williams stood up to Paul Martin and Stephen Harper. Well, why can't Dwight Ball stand up to Mr. Trudeau and say, we need help now? We're a have-not province. Anyways, that's all I have to say for now. Thank you.
Thanks, Ed. And if I could just add one point on the health care transfer issue that our government should be all over, because it's an important one, is that the plan in Ottawa is to have the health care two provinces, whatever the transfers are, be done on a per capita basis. And that is particularly difficult for a province like ours for two reasons. Number one, our population is so scattered, which means the delivery of health care is very expensive. And number two, we have the oldest population in the country, and naturally older people have more health care needs and are costlier to provide those services for than younger. So on, there should be some adjustment to that, and that should be something our provincial government is all over. When a health minister from here goes to FedProf health meetings, that's something that that minister should be shouting from the rooftops. Number one.
Yes, my name is Wayne Lucas, for those of you that don't know me. And I want to throw a bouquet to Lorraine. I saw Lorraine on TV tonight. She was picking up for library technicians in Newfoundland, Labrador. And if you don't know, CUPE represents 95 libraries, or we did, 95 libraries in Newfoundland, Labrador. We got the sour news today that 54 of those libraries, mostly in rural Newfoundland, Labrador, by the way, are going to close down. Now, in those libraries, we got 250 employees, mostly women. And it's a known fact that in Newfoundland and Labrador, women are 52% of the population. But they also only make 74 cents for every dollar that a man makes. Now, in Newfoundland and Labrador, the Newfoundland government's first act, or one of the first acts, are to lay off a good portion of those library workers throughout the province of Newfoundland and Labrador. Well, I explained it tonight on NTV like a punch in the face to women in Newfoundland and Labrador, but not only to women in Newfoundland and Labrador, but to rural Newfoundland and Labrador, because rural Newfoundland and Labrador are going to take the brunt of this. And once again, I just want to thank the New Democrats for standing up for those women in rural Newfoundland and Labrador, and for the library technicians who are members of CUPE. The second point that I'd like to make is that I'm sort of bewildered why people don't take it serious. CUPE has been advocating, along with the New Democrats, for a long, long time right now, that for every $1 we would spend in child care, we would get $2 back. And in Newfoundland and Labrador, in case people don't know it, St. John's has the highest cost of child care next to Toronto anywhere in Canada. So why doesn't the government, or either one of the governments, sit down with the New Democrats and with CUPE and find out what we've got to say? Talk to the Council of Canadians. If it can work in Quebec, it can work in Newfoundland and Labrador. So I think we've got a real good solution right here, and I'm not telling you that I'm opposed to Muskrat Falls, because I don't know enough about Muskrat Falls, but I'm pretty suspicious about it. But if you could put $1.3 billion just this year alone in Muskrat Falls, let's put $1.3 billion into child care, give women in society, give families in society a fighting chance, let them be able to go back to work, give our children an opportunity to have a good start on education, and maybe it just might work. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Wayne. And tell you the truth, we'd probably get a bit of change back from that $1.3 billion.
I come from a community that's considered one of the most low-income communities in the city of Rabbitown. As vice chairman of the board of directors there at the community center, I've had neighbors coming up to me going, what are we going to do? How are we going to feed our kids? How the hell can I afford to go and take the taxi up to Sobeys or down to Dominion to get some food for the youngsters? You know, it's when they're trembling because they don't know, they're not being told anything, and then we're patronized with this little incentive, the low-income incentive. That's patronizing. What that says to me is, like, we cannot live off of the money we get, they get now, or we get now. It's, I'm so angry, and I'm so worried, and I am truly scared, because I can see what our community is going to turn into. People are going to lose faith. They're going to start, you know, addiction is bad enough. This is going to bring out the worst in people. It's going to bring a great deal of harm to our communities. And I've seen mothers, like single moms, who are saying, I can't afford child care now. How can I afford it going forward? What's going to happen? And, you know, as a person, when you take a leadership role in any community, you find it very hard and extremely difficult to look in the face and say, I don't have the answer. I wish I had the answer for you. I wish I could reach out and help in some form or another. I found during the toughest of times, those with little give very much. We've decided as a community that we are going to put the quilt together and we're going to fight this every step of the way. We can't be apathetic anymore. And when they say we have no fight left, I question that. There's a heck of a lot of fight in this province. You know, I remember years ago when Earl was standing up for the fisher people of this province. And I remember camping out at the taxation center. And I seen the fear in their faces. And you know what? I have never seen the fear that I see now in a lot of other people. And they say, you're fear-mongering. They fear-monger.
Thanks very much. I'm glad there's still a few people around who remember that one at the tax center. We had quite a time there. By the way, if anyone just wanted to clarify, because it might seem rude that I'm on my phone with the thumbs going, that's actually to tweet out comments from the thing so that they get out to the general public. So it wasn't that I wasn't paying close attention to everything that's being said, but want to get the messages out in social media so those who weren't able to make it tonight can try and keep up with a little bit at least with what's going on. Delegate at mic one.
Hi, my name is Lorraine D. When you get stressed out, angry, whatnot, you have the fight or flee. Well, my husband and I are fleeing this island. I was born and reared here in Newfoundland. I love the island, and I am not going to stay. I can't afford to stay. My husband went down to get his guaranteed income supplement done. So they had a formula there for your amount of money that each made. My money for last year, according to the Service Canada people, was $56.82. How the heck can I pay an extra $300? We have one car, that gas is going up, and everything. I feel cornered and we are fleeing. And this government is more conservative than Danny Williams or Paul Davis ever was. They should be cheering them in the House rather than questioning them, because it is everything that they would do.
May I ask, sure.
But anyway, Earl, I guess I'm in your category too, because I remember when the gas tax came out, it was for road repairs. How many road repairs come out of the gas tax now? Anyway, I'll give other people a chance to talk.
My name is Gavin Will. I'm Deputy Mayor of Portugal Cove St. Phillips, and I'm very concerned about the aftershocks of this budget on people in my community. I'm not going to speak to that right now, though. I'm going to speak in terms of my other role, which is as publisher of a book publisher named Boulder Publications. This is one of the books that my company is using. This book here is written by a Newfoundlander, is edited by Newfoundlanders, it is the graphic design is by Newfoundlanders, it is sold throughout the world. And when this government announced that it was going to be imposing a book tax on all things, so that we'd become the only province with such a creature, I was perplexed, because I thought that the whole idea of this government was diversifying the economy. And the creative commons, the creative industries, book publishing, writing, art, sculpture, etc., dance, you name it, these industries are very small in comparison to, say, oil and gas, but they employ a lot of people. A lot of income is generated by the creative industries around here. And for the government to say, that doesn't matter. What really counts here is making $1 million or $2 million a year, which they expect to get from imposing a book tax on books. It's just incredible. And that doesn't even touch the literacy point, which has already been covered by Earl here. It's just unbelievable. Thank you.
Yeah, just briefly, I think what people miss, and I was proud that the first announcement we made after the starting gun went off for the provincial election campaign last fall was at a small art gallery to say that if elected, we would significantly increase funding for the Newfoundland Labrador Arts Council in recognition of the fact
that the arts are not only part of our cultural identity and are just our sense
of ourselves, but also a very important economic driver that provides jobs, creates economic opportunity, draws tourists, increases our profile around the world, and is something that just makes good economic sense for a government to invest in. And it's absolutely ludicrous that at a time when we're challenged and we need our phenomenally creative artists to be out there, kind of speaking on our behalf and creating art on our behalf, and increasing our profile around the world, to be chiseling on that is really ridiculous. Mike, one.
Can I just interrupt for 1 minute? But really, could people identify who they are before they speak? Okay, thank you.
Jim Din, president of the Newfoundland Labrador Teachers Association. Lorraine started off this evening with a story about a family that was facing a lot of fear and frustration. I heard the gentleman from Raton talk about the fear in his community. Well, I have a letter here, an email that was sent to me from a teacher that best captures the fear that teachers have. Mr. Kirby has been so singularly focused on and demonstrated how the association has been misleading that he's missed the point that 140 teachers in kindergarten will not make up for the 219 teachers that he's gutted from the rest of the system and the effect it's going to have on the students of this province. I've been asking that teachers to contact their MHA, and there are a number of them here tonight, a number of teachers here tonight who are here because they're out of concern. Hello, I know you're asking us to contact our MHAs, but honestly, every time something else comes out about the budget and the impact of teaching, it brings tears to my eyes. I don't know how to express how upset and scared I am about the impact on my students. I've never felt such an incredible sadness and fear when it comes to teaching. How can we do it? The letters that teachers have sent me have been talking about that very fear. That's the fear. This is a minister who, when he was in opposition, gave an awful lot of teachers hope that we would see less multigrading, more resources to take care of mental health and mental health issues of our students, more supports for IRTs, but he's done the very opposite. He's missed the point. This government budget was supposed to support mental health initiatives in the school. It's not happening. I've heard this frustration from teachers, and I can tell you the frustration is about what it means to their students. This is a government that has taxed books, has cut back in education, has closed library boards. I listened to Mr. Kirby today talk about, the regionalization will make it simpler. I guess you'd have to drive to the regional centers, and gas is up to 16 cents. That's going to make that impossible. And he talks about the use of online services. Well, I can tell you from my teachers in the various remote areas that high-speed internet is a dream. So
this is a government, I guess, this budget has basically taken hope. This is a hope away from people. This is a government that doesn't deal in hope. And my fear is that Newfoundland and Labrador has suddenly become a very much darker province. Thank you.
Suffering because of this. I'm 71 years old. I still have to keep working. I have no pension except for CPP and OAS. I have no family here except for my beloved husband and lots of friends. But I'm worried about the fact that right now I have to choose between dental care and physiotherapy or paying the utilities, the mortgage, buying gas, heating oil, that kind of thing. And with the levy and with increased taxation, I don't know how people in our position, there are many, many, many of us who are working people, can afford to, I can't afford to stay, I can't afford to leave. The other thing I'm afraid of is when I get to the point, cross my fingers, it'll be a long time from now, when I need to have more help, when I won't be able to do for myself, I can't afford private health care. Home care, I don't know if that's going to be available, but I probably won't be able to afford that. I'm so afraid I might have to end up in some Frankenstein facility that's half private, half public, and falling through the cracks with diapers that don't get changed, baths that don't happen, food that's substandard, all that kind of thing. So those are my fears. I have, well, there are lots of fears, but those are two paramount ones. I also have a puzzlement. When the government says that they're not going to cut a whole lot of jobs because many of them will just disappear through attrition, well, if a person retires, that leaves a job that a young person can fill. If that person retires and that job disappears, then there's still a job loss. There's no job for that person coming up next. Now, one more thing, and I don't mean this to be a sacrilege, but with Newfoundland having the highest illiteracy rate in the country, cutting out half of our libraries, taxing books. Do you remember those Newfie jokes in the 70s?
Yeah.
It's going to come back and it's going to bite us hard.
Yeah, good evening. My name is Ralph Morris and I represent several seniors groups across this province. And I think the sister just was there, I applaud her because she's put in perspective pretty much what I've been hearing from a multitude of seniors over this past week and a half. And I'm not going to go through the things that she said, but the message she gave is certainly the message that I'm receiving from seniors from Port of Asp to St. John's to St. Anthony to Goose Bay to Nain and all over. I counted them this evening. I got 471 emails from them so far. That's what I got. That's not saying the phone calls. That's not telling about the tweets and the Twitters and all those people that you meet and the people you meet in the supermarkets and around. But there's a couple of things in this that I am going to talk on, and Earl alluded to one of them, and that is the dental program for seniors in this province, which has been basically wiped out, and for people who are on low income, who will never be able to afford to get those for themselves. I was on Paddy Daly a couple of days ago with him. I suggested to Paddy, maybe the seniors in this province now should either start to buy blenders or get some of their neighbors to chew up the food for them before they go to have that meal. But that's what it's come down to, basically, because they're not going to be able to chew their food and properly digest it. Subsequently, they're going to end up with all sorts of abdominal problems and all sorts of health problems, so that's going to happen. But there were four who got a message from the Minister of Finance about 3 days ago and asking if we'd meet with her and some other members yesterday evening at the Confederation Building. So we as a coalition went in and we met with the Minister of Finance, the Minister of Health, and the Minister responsible for seniors issues in this province. The first thing they put on the reason that they called this meeting, they got wind of the fact that we're starting a tour of the island on Sunday coming on the west coast, and we'll be coming east. And I guess they were going to try to tell us that we were going to put their issues, their spin on this and go out on the road, but unfortunately, that didn't work. They have a chart done, and basically it has two things. You look at the taxation rate of 2006, you look at it 10 years later in 2016, and they'll say the exact same rate applies to the income tax and all others right down through. That's what they were saying, that you're no worse off today than you were in 2006. Well, you know, talk about progress. But there's another thing in this that we're finding, and I spoke this evening on NTV about the same thing. And I started getting calls from seniors, particularly seniors, the widows particularly seem to be hit hard with this, and they're living in basement apartments, they're living in apartment buildings, and they've been told over the past week by their landlord that their rents are going anywhere from $100 to $150 of an increase. And a lady I talked to on Friday evening, I think she put it pretty well in perspective. She said, I live on Smallwood Drive in Mount Pearl. I was just told by my landlord that my rent is going to be $950. I was paying $800. She said, I got $1,100 to live on. I'm not going to have much left. But there's something else that they brought out to us yesterday evening. I don't know if Lorraine and them have seen this yet. But apparently you can fill out a form on this levy that's going to be started in July. And you can have the taxes either paid out monthly out of this, or you can have it deferred to the end of the year. Now, people on low income, this is a recipe for disaster for starting with, because they're going to look at the fact that there's going to be no reduction until the end of the year. When the taxes come, then they're going to end up with this huge bill that they're going to be less afforded to be able to pay. So they're going to be not only in trouble with their landlord, not only in trouble with the grocery stores, they're going to also be in trouble with the tax man. So we tell you, brothers and sisters, step up, talk to it. If there's a rally around, turn up at it. We're hoping to have a big one next week. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.